Hello, I'm Montse Alvarado, and this is EWTN News In Depth.
America's longest war is officially over. The last soldier leaves Afghanistan after the largest evacuation airlift in U.S. history.
Due to the chaos and the very real security risks on the ground in Kabul the last several weeks, they took whatever means they could to get out of the country.
What's next for the thousands of Afghan refugees who escaped the country in those last desperate days? We talked to representatives from two organizations deeply committed to providing compassionate help as they resettle.
Take that risk of being vulnerable and realize that there are people who are going to embrace you and accept you and not judge you.
The church and mental health awareness. Catholic resources are at the ready to give relief to people in distress.
It grew because God was growing. It wasn't about us. God was doing the watering. We just showed up.
And faithful sisters ask God to use their hands for his work. How their mission in poverty-stricken Haiti has grown and multiplied to help people there build a better future. EWTN News In Depth is next.
America's longest war is over. After 20 years of armed conflict, this past week, the last troops withdrew from Afghanistan after the U.S. military completed the largest airlift evacuation in American history. This video, released by the Defense Department this week, shows images of the very last American soldiers and last flight that departed Hamid Karzai International Airport by the deadline of August 31st, taking off 1 minute before midnight. The last soldier to board, Major General Chris Donahue, commander of the 82nd Airborne. In the last few days of the war, much of the focus was on the airport, where a desperate population of Afghans hoped to be evacuated out of a country now overtaken by the Taliban.
The United States evacuated some 6,000 American citizens and a total of more than 124,000 civilians. And we did it all in the midst of a pandemic and in the face of grave and growing threats. I am incredibly proud of those who made it happen, and they made it happen with grit and skill and humanity.
In remarks at the Pentagon, Secretary of Defense Lloyd Austin and Joint Chiefs Chairman General Mark Milley reminded us of the war's heavy toll. In the course of the 20-year war, more than 2,400 U.S. troops lost their lives, and more than 20,000 were wounded. Hundreds of NATO allies were killed, and many tens of Afghan soldiers and civilians perished.
No se tuvieron en cuenta, parece. No quiero juzgar.
In a radio interview on Wednesday, Pope Francis called the U.S. withdrawal from Afghanistan legitimate, but criticized how it was carried out. The Holy Father also criticized the West's involvement in Afghanistan as an outsider's attempt to impose democracy. He also said the Vatican is currently using its diplomatic powers to discourage the new Taliban regime from waging reprisals against Afghans opposing its rule. Tens of thousands of evacuated Afghan refugees are expected to resettle in the United States. Many come with nothing but their clothes on their backs, having experienced a horrifying escape from the Taliban. Humanitarian groups, charities, and religious organizations are stepping up to welcome the stranger, including many Catholic groups. Joining us to share her experience helping Afghan refugees is Judi Harris, the Refugee Resettlement Director at St. Vincent Catholic Charities in Michigan. Thank you for joining us, Judi. You were sent as a representative for the Lansing Diocese to help refugees processing through Fort Lee, Virginia. Tell us about their transition experience. What did you see?
So it was a very interesting experience, very emotional at times. So it started off with when people would get off the bus at Fort Lee, the soldiers there, you know, the U.S. military was there really to welcome them with open arms. They were really wonderful and welcoming. They applauded everybody when they got off the bus. The little kids got flags.
Oh, wow.
Really heartening because I know a lot of the service members have been waiting years and working for years to get this population here. So I think that that was really great for them to be able to do that. And from there, you know, it was a lot of ushering people around the base, you know, helping them to get, you know, their COVID tests and all their medical tests and their documentation prepared. and just getting them ready to go off to their final destination, wherever that would be.
And you were helping mostly Afghan interpreters and military personnel. What's next in efforts to resettle them?
So I think the process is that they would go to these military bases, and they still will. They'll go to military bases, they'll get all of their paperwork and processing done, and then they'll go on to their final destination. And that's all over the country. Every resettlement site in the country, I think, is expecting some of these folks to arrive. Some of them will come to Lansing, and so we're getting ready to prepare for them here.
That's great. Is the Lansing Diocese sponsoring any families or just individuals? I know you were talking about little kids. Are they coming in on their own?
Oh, no. So we'll do all families and, you know, single individuals. Whoever needs to come will be taking care of all of them. Yeah.
And are children coming unaccompanied? Is that something that you're seeing?
I've heard of that. I haven't seen anybody coming to Lansing. There are special groups that work with unaccompanied refugee minors, and they put them into foster care programs. But that is not St. Vincent's. We do not do that program.
Okay. Michigan is known as a resettling community. I know that you've worked on this for a long time, and your organization led efforts since World War II to house refugees. What's different this time?
So this time, it's just going to be the speed in which people start coming that's going to make it a little chaotic and a little crazy, but it's still, you know, a life-saving endeavor, and it always has been. It's always about getting people out of harm's way and into a safe place and able to start a life for themselves.
Are there other refugees from other conflicts that you're currently helping? Is this something that's going to overwhelm your team?
We'll be a little overwhelmed, but yes, we were already slated to increase from about 100 refugees this year to 400 refugees in 2022. So we were already expecting a big increase there. And then on top of that, we should be seeing maybe up to 300 Afghans.
And those people that you were already expecting, what conflicts were they coming from, or what countries?
So we'll see a lot of people from the Democratic Republic of Congo, Iraq, Syria, Somalia, Sudan, Burma. Anywhere that there's conflict, really, we get people from Ethiopia. Anyone who's being resettled, we pride ourselves in our diversity and our ability to resettle people from almost anywhere. We want to be open. When we get the call that says, we have this person coming from this country, can you take them? We always want to be able to say yes.
Judi, why do you do this work?
Well, it's God's work, you know. We're doing it because our service to God, because this is what we're supposed to do, is welcome the stranger. Personally, I feel like refugees are among the most vulnerable people on earth. They've really been put through a lot, and all they really need is just some open arms and people to say, you know, we love you and we value your life, and we have a place for you here.
Judi, what can people do to help?
There are many things that people can do to help. I mean, our biggest need right now in Lansing is housing. So if anybody has any rental properties or knows of anybody with rental properties or even hotels that are willing to offer support, when people start coming quickly, we might not be able to find housing for them right away. So that's our biggest concern right now, is being able to find housing as soon as possible. Also, we can use financial donations. Right now, our immigration law clinic is furiously working to help people, Afghans who are already here, to apply for humanitarian parole to be part of this program. And then once they get here, we will also need some financial support. Because of the quickness of people coming here, some Afghans coming might not have access to all the government benefits. And so we might have to find other resources to help feed them and keep a roof over their heads until they start working.
And probably provide medical care too.
Right.
Well, we're grateful for the work that you're doing, and this is a call for everyone to help and reach out to resettle and welcome, as you said, welcome the stranger here in America.
Yes.
Thank you, Judi.
Thank you.
For those airlifted out of Afghanistan, the mad dash to escape has passed. But many, without all their documentation in order, may now face steep legal hurdles during their next steps in their resettlement. How will they get out of immigration limbo? The group Human Rights First has been providing pro bono legal assistance since the Haitian refugee crisis of the 1980s. Robyn Barnard is Senior Advocacy Counsel for Refugee Protection at Human Rights First. She and her team have been working round the clock on the Afghan crisis. Robyn, your organization has a 40-year history of providing legal assistance to refugees, and we want to get to that in a minute. But first, your team was also involved in the frantic scramble to get as many Afghans out of the country as possible. Tell us about that effort.
Well, it was not something that we undertook alone. We worked in a coalition with many other groups called Evacuate Our Allies. And this was a combination of human rights organizations and veteran groups and just other people who are very concerned about what was happening to our Afghan allies and other vulnerable Afghans. So we were working around the clock the past 3 weeks to try and get as many of our Afghan allies out of the country as possible. But this was something that we started several months before in urging the president to start the evacuation. And sadly, that evacuation did not start until very late in the day. And, you know, that's the resulting chaos that we saw over the last month out of Kabul.
You speak of Afghan allies. Can you describe that for me? Who qualifies as an ally?
So these are Afghans that have worked alongside our troops and U.S. government forces in Afghanistan for many years. They put themselves in harm's way in the hopes of building a better Afghanistan alongside the United States. So when we say Afghan allies, we mean those Afghans that bravely stood beside U.S. troops and forces in Afghanistan. And it's not just the Afghan allies that we've been concerned about, although they're very high at the top of the list. But there are other members of Afghan society that include civil society actors, women, judges, others who've been working towards a better future in Afghanistan and now face a really terrifying prospect of life under the Taliban.
And Robyn, thanks to your help and many others, thousands of Afghans did make it out and are headed to the U.S. What kind of immigration issues will they be facing here? And how does Human Rights help? Human Rights First help?
So because there was a very slow movement over the past 4 years of many of the immigrant visas for those Afghan allies that I mentioned before, unfortunately, many of them didn't receive final approval of those visas. So they are now coming to the United States in the evacuation process and arriving here and needing to start the process of seeking protection. That is something called asylum. It's a very complicated process under the best of circumstances. But for folks that have fled their country with just a small handbag, something sometimes less in their possession, they're often, facing a very steep hurdle in meeting the standards in our laws to qualify for asylum. That's why having pro bono and quality legal counsel at your side is essential. And that is something that we are stepping up to provide and to ensure that these Afghans are not left alone through this process and that they have assistance and support to see out this process of seeking protection in the United States.
And what about those refugees who left Afghanistan and may now be stuck in an intermediate way station in a third country, or maybe their paperwork was incomplete or stolen or lost in this crush to get past the Taliban at the airport? Do you get involved in any of those cases?
Yes, we've been hearing from many Afghans who were able to get out of the country either on an evacuation flight or through some other means, maybe a land route into a neighboring country. And they're now seeking to find their way to the United States to get to safety. So they are definitely of top of our mind here at Human Rights First. We are standing up legal teams to help them in seeking different pathways to resettle in the United States. And it's something that we've urged the U.S. government to pay close attention to and to not let those Afghans remain stranded in third countries. Many of these people are included in that Afghan allies population that I described earlier. And just due to the chaos and the very real security risks on the ground in Kabul the last several weeks, they took whatever means they could to get out of the country. And we need to stand by them and make sure that we bring them to safety now.
That's right. We can't blame them for using anything they could to get out. There have been many refugee crises over the decades that your organization has been active with, going back to your original mission. Do you view this Afghan situation as uniquely challenging, or are there other situations that have been equally as difficult?
Well, it's certainly something that I haven't experienced in my career, being in real time, talking to families in Kabul over the last several weeks and speaking to them about how to navigate the very precarious route to get to the airport to the U.S. troops and to get into the airport to seek safety. So it's definitely unique in that experience, I think. But we do see many refugees that are in need of protection. And most recently, and continuing at our southern border, there are many refugees that are waiting in Mexican cities in very dangerous conditions and are unable to exercise their legal right now to seek protection due to an ongoing barrier that was put up by the previous administration, blocking asylum seekers from seeking protection at our southern border. So that is right. Something that is ongoing and top of our minds as well.
Well, we will be thinking about you and praying for your efforts to help all of our Afghan allies. Thank you so much, Robyn.
Thank you for having me.
EWTN News In Depth will continue to monitor the refugee situation in the weeks to come. We'll talk again to groups trying to assist refugees as they adjust to their new lives and bring in expert voices to tell us how we, as Catholics, can welcome the stranger.
The schools are not open, the businesses are not open, the hospitals are slammed. There's not water in your home, and there's not going to be electricity.
The governor of Louisiana assesses the harsh situation after Hurricane Ida slams into his state and warns those who evacuated not to come home yet. Days after the Category 4 hurricane tore through, causing massive property damage, more than 1 million Louisiana and Mississippi residents were still without power. The entire city of New Orleans went dark. Authorities say the outage could continue for as long as a month. In many communities, roads remain impassable, gas pumps are not working, there's no place to buy food, and oppressive heat with no air conditioning is making life even more miserable. Relief agencies like Catholic Charities are scrambling to help, but they too are impacted by the storm.
They don't have power either. They have nursing homes that are running on generators. They had a generator fail at a residential care facility for 40 special needs patients or special needs people. Residents who then had to be moved to a nursing home that is also running on generator power. So we're trying to work through some of those issues of fuel shortages and just staff not being able to get where they would need to go to do some response activities.
The remnants of Ida moved up the coast, causing tornadoes and massive flooding in the Northeast. Many people caught by surprise and needing rescue from high waters. These images are from the New York and New Jersey area. Water gushed into the New York City subway system, flooding the tracks and stranding passengers. The entire subway service was suspended. More video features flooded streets in Harlem. At least 14 people are dead in New York and New Jersey, where cars were abandoned and ambulances stuck in high water. Our prayers go out to all those affected by this severe weather system. Next, we turn our attention to a health problem that impacts millions of us. How the Catholic Church is stepping up to help those struggling with mental health issues. EWTN News In Depth will be right back.
And don't forget to check on your closest friends and family members, because sometimes, you know, they really could be struggling.
Removing the stigma of anxiety and depression, the effort in many local parishes to help those experiencing mental suffering. And Catholic schools brace for the beginning of school and the battle to minimize the impact of COVID. A look inside one very large Catholic school district ahead.
How faith and mental health intertwine. Welcome back to EWTN News In Depth. I'm Montse Alvarado. While there's still a lot of stigma attached to mental health and therapy, there's a calling from professionals and church leaders to provide greater care and understanding for those suffering from mental illness. Reporter Mark Irons explains.
If you say one in four families know or love someone who has mental illness, diagnosed or maybe undiagnosed.
Charlene Cotra, executive director of the National Catholic Partnership on Disability, says friends, family, coworkers, or parishioners could be silently hurting, dealing with things like anxiety or depression.
In an effort to help those struggling with mental health issues, there is a push to provide more resources at the parish level so that church leadership knows how to assist people in the pews who may be suffering.
Pope Francis hopes protection of those with mental illness will be strengthened. At a conference on mental health earlier this year, he spoke of the need to fully overcome the stigma with which mental illness has often been branded, and in general, to ensure that the culture of community prevails over the mentality of rejection. In one high-profile case, a top Catholic Church official sought help to overcome anxiety, depression, and insomnia. In 2019, Bishop James Conley of the Diocese of Lincoln, Nebraska, went on a medical leave of absence to address his concerns. He said, "I was trying to fix myself, and as time went on, I realized that I couldn't fix myself." He now encourages others to take care of their own mental health.
Most people will go to their pastor first.
Though Katra says people may take their own issues to their parish priest, he may not be fully prepared to help.
That's why it's also important for us at NCPD to be able to reach and teach and train and provide resources, create and provide resources for our leadership.
And she hopes more and more Catholics around the country will jumpstart mental health ministries at their own parish, like Claire Shinette did.
It's the laity responsibility to do it.
Shinette worked in the mental health profession for years and saw the needs within her own Catholic church in Houston, Texas.
Once we got into pulling people together, people were, families were more open about their experience. You've got resources just with family members that have been doing this walk for a number of years with their loved ones.
Judi Barr from Tacoma Park, Maryland says her parish has started to help those with mental illness. Faith has guided her through some dark times.
And I just trust that Christ has an answer to all of our problems.
In Barr's case, she experienced psychotic episodes and bipolar disorder. In addition to prayer, she says medication and family support have been key.
What's been successful for me is other people taking action in my behalf. And since then, taking my medicine as prescribed.
Barr also sees a Catholic therapist. In the Diocese of Arlington, Virginia, psychologist Frank Moncher told us about psychology from a Catholic perspective.
What we would do is use standard psychological techniques that have been proven through science to be effective in helping people and make sure that we're doing those in a way that's morally acceptable.
Moncher says a Catholic approach to therapy is not just for Catholics and warned that mainstream therapeutic remedies could be harmful.
In the secular therapy world, they may have different goals or ends in mind, and so they may be willing to recommend things or to do certain interventions that actually in the end are detrimental to the human person.
A main takeaway: don't be afraid to seek help and be aware of the needs of others.
Listening to someone talk from their heart.
I would say reach out for help.
Moncher believes the church needs to keep this perspective.
There's no shame in seeking counseling.
Mark Irons, EWTN News In Depth.
Finding a mental health professional whose guidance will align with the Catholic understanding of the human person, marriage, and family can be difficult. But one university, Divine Mercy University, specializes in training psychology and counseling through a Catholic lens. Father Charles Sikorsky, president of the university, joins us on the record. Father Sikorsky, thank you for joining us. Quick question. You have led Divine Mercy University since 2007. Why is forming mental health professionals such a critical mission today?
Well, I think first, when we look at the human person, we see the human person is body, mind, and soul. And if we're going to help a person flourish, if we're going to help a person overcome psychological and mental difficulties, we have to look at the whole person. It's not just a physical thing, it's not just a mental thing, but it's also a soul part. There's a spiritual part to that. And we need to have a holistic understanding of the human person if we truly want to help them. And so that's why we're here. You know, the word psychology, psyche in Greek, means soul. And a lot of our modern science has forgotten about that. And so we need that holistic view of the person in order to really help them overcome fully and the difficulties that they have, that they might have on a mental health level, but also to help them to grow in a life of flourishing.
And is that really the difference between the secular approach and the Catholic approach to mental health?
I think that's one big difference. First of all, just how you look at the person. And do you see this person as a problem, or do you see this person as made in God's likeness and image, who is wounded and struggling with certain things? And so we feel like we have a real realistic view of the human person. Talking to one of our alumni recently, he was mentioning that in his work, he works at a secular hospital, very good hospital for psychiatric problems. But he said some of the, where he sees a difference is he sees the person in a different light than some of his colleagues who maybe give up a little more quickly on trying to work with someone because they just see the problem and the difficulty, and they don't see the bigger picture of this person's been, you know, created by God, is loved by God, and has a purpose for being in this life, no matter how weak, no matter how, you know, many times there are great challenges that they face. We have to see that to give us as therapists hope that we can make a difference.
And you're talking about your alumni. How does your Catholic mission, the Catholic nature of your mission, impact how you form and train these students, practically speaking?
Right. Well, we start off, we have courses on, we call Catholic anthropology, right, which is understanding the human person, understanding human nature as the church does. And we rely not just on theology, there's some theological principles, but there are many philosophical principles that going back Aristotle, Augustine, Aquinas, all the way up to John Paul II, who wrote a lot about human nature. And we give them a base of that to understand the true nature of the human person. And so that's the foundation of it. Part of that is obviously being open to faith and spirituality. A colleague we work with here, he's an Orthodox Jew, who psychologist, and he started out not, he wears a yarmulke, right? So he had many of his clients would ask him questions about faith, about God, about spirituality, and he wasn't quite sure how to respond because he went to one of the leading universities in the country, but didn't have that kind of a background. Well, he found out that well over 50% of his clients wanted to discuss that. Mm. He's done some great research on it. So it's not just Catholics, it's other people of faith who see this need that people want to talk about faith, spirituality, and God in their therapy. And so we train our students are able to be open to that, and obviously, but also to have, to see that as something positive, as a way to help people heal, and to really help them to flourish better.
Can you give us a little bit of background on the history of mental health in the Catholic Church? Have they been at odds with each other, as some people like to say, or has this been an easy conversation and this mission that you have flows naturally?
Great question. So historically, it was seen more as part of a philosophical psychology. I guess the big break happened around the time of Sigmund Freud, okay, where you saw this really a secularization of it, a really reduction of the human person to his base desires and so forth. And that caused some tension between professional psychology and the church for a long time. And with good reason. There was reasons why Catholics would be skeptical about a Freudian approach. But as time goes on, I think the field, there have been different movements in the field. So there's been some progress that has been made. But there was a lot of tension.
Well, let's talk about these tensions and those places where now with the resurgence of gender ideology and different challenges to mental health professionals, how you're on the front lines of that as well.
You know, we believe and certainly we know that faith and being faithful to the principles of the church and being faithful to moral principles is the right way to go. It's the only thing that truly works. I think a lot of these other ideas are imploding on so many people. Now there's great risks and damages with some of the things that are going on out there. But I think we need to be engaged, and we need to be proposing a Catholic view as a solution.
One last quick question. How has COVID affected your operation? Are you more in demand because you know that there are mental health effects that are going to be rampant throughout the country that you'll have to address?
Yeah, well, I think it's the whole mental health, not just us, but we don't have definitive data on this, but some of the studies coming out show that the need for mental health in the last year or since COVID started has been doubled. So you went from having maybe around 20% of the population seeking or needing mental health treatment. If that doubles, it's 40%. I'm sure more numbers will be coming out of exactly what that is, but everyone has been seeing a significant increase. And so the work we're doing is more important than ever. There's more than ever we need We need people who are dedicated to helping people with mental health disorders. And even beyond that, in the church and in Christian circles, we need more and more people of faith because of the need to address people holistically. We need more and more people who are open to that, more and more people who want to do that, want to help solve these problems. So it's an immense problem. I don't think we fully realize all of the psychological and mental health consequences of the pandemic and how it's been playing out, but the need is certainly enormous.
Well, we're grateful that you're there on the front lines, forming the people who will be able to see us through that crisis. Thank you so much, Father Sikorski.
You're welcome.
There are many resources to find a Catholic therapist, including CatholicTherapist.com. It was founded by Allison Ricciardi, who was a guest on Mother Angelica's show and the Abundant Life show here on EWTN. When we return, the conversation continues about the church and mental health.
Teachers, faculty and staff have seen a lot of social isolation and a tremendous increase in their anxiety.
Reaching out with help. Two takes from a Catholic perspective on how to ease mental anguish. Success stories ahead. And a little later, we take you to Boston for what's called the Feast of All Feasts. We tell you about a century-old religious festival keeping Italian Catholic traditions alive.
We continue with our discussion about the relationship between the Catholic Church and mental health sciences. The field is growing, with more religious and lay people taking part and promoting therapy. We're joined now by Mikol Amalu, the founder and director of the Face of Mercy, which advocates for mental health services and education within the church, and Dr. Father Ryan Duns, assistant professor of theology at Marquette University. Father Ryan, you answered the call to help students on Marquette's campus with the mental health effects of COVID. What were you seeing in the students?
You know, I think all of us, teachers, faculty and staff, have seen a lot of social isolation and a tremendous increase in their anxiety. And this manifests in a lot of ways, the students disconnecting from their work, finding it really difficult to pray or to cultivate a spiritual life. And that presented a real compelling call to a lot of us to respond in new, creative, and innovative ways to meet their needs.
Mikol, your nonprofit, The Face of Mercy, was recently launched. Why did you feel the call to advocate for mental health awareness within the church? And what does it look like?
Yeah, I really saw that people living with mental illness are kind of the outcasts of society today. And while in the secular world, there's more and more movement to caring for those with mental illness, it really isn't talked about within the church. And this is something where we should be taking the lead, much as the church has taken the lead on caring for the poor and education throughout history. Our teachings on human dignity and the preferential treatment for the vulnerable really should have us leading this cause.
And how has your mission changed with COVID?
So our organization launched right before COVID. And so much of it has just kind of been, okay, how do we grow as a tiny organization when everything is virtual? And the needs of people have changed. We did a survey right before of what people are experiencing in parishes, but then parishes closed. And so what community they had and support was often taken away.
Father Ryan, what about you? What kind of strategies or help did you provide your students?
So at Marquette, we really adhere to this Jesuit principle of cura personalis. We're caring for the whole person, the body, the soul, and certainly we take account of mental health. What I found most helpful is walking with students, especially during the time of lockdown when social distance needed to be maintained. I was logging 20 and 30,000 steps a day because I made myself available to walk with students whenever they wanted to go outside. And often enough, we'd walk for 2 miles without having to say very much of anything. They just wanted to know that someone was accompanying them and that they were being seen and could be listened to with their problems and with their issues.
That's beautiful. We often think about accompaniment as something that you can do over the phone, but you were actually physically going out, logging steps, as you said. That's good to hear. Mikol, in trying to help the next generation, what do you think are the causes of spikes in depression and suicide?
Isolation and the lack of community, I think, is huge. Like, even before COVID, I think it's something that young people have been experiencing, that communities are more transient,
people are less available, and it's such a culture of busyness that you don't see that kind of accompaniment that Father was just talking about, that really being together, which is part of what being human is all about and essential for our mental and spiritual growth.
And what can you say is the cause of that? Is it social media? Is it a lack of understanding of the way that we're supposed to be in relationship with each other, lack of formation?
I think it's a whole host. I don't know that there's any one cause, but I think just as a culture, that tendency towards busyness and social media, a lot of these things just kind of pull us away from each other rather than living and kind of being with people in person.
Father Ryan, what kind of response did you see from the students in walking with them? What did they say in those few moments when they said something? What did they say they needed?
Often enough, it's as if the spiritual cry is, does anyone recognize that I'm here, and does anybody know me? And they have all these experiences and all these confusions and doubts and stresses in their lives. And what I saw, if I make it scriptural, is sort of like the walk to Emmaus, where the two disciples are walking along and they're totally confused and uncertain about what happened and their hearts are broken. And they meet a stranger along the way who walks with them and retells the story, reframes the narrative, and gives them a new way of seeing the world around them. And that's what I found. It's not that they had to be fixed, because they're not broken. They need to have their horizons opened up a bit. And that's where a real sincere conversation, knowing that they're loved and cared for, I think it's transformative for them. And that's what I saw, the transformation happening just about on every walk.
We're not our hearts burning within us, right? That's the phrase, that reframing of, rather than thinking about the brokenness, thinking about the beauty and what the church has to offer. Nicole, how is the church uniquely prepared to help all people who struggle with issues of mental health?
I think that there's so much healing available in the church through the sacraments, through confession, through prayer and a spiritual life, and then also the community that is kind of built into the way our church operates and in parishes. And so the more we can have the church recognize the importance of talking about mental health and illness and recognizing the good that is available outside the church in psychology, in therapy and medication, I really think the fullness of healing is available to those with mental illness who have both, both those secular scientific interventions and then also faith and prayer.
And is there value in being aggressively available online as well? I know that you have a very active Instagram channel.
Yes, I found that this is a great place where many other Christian mental health advocacy is happening, but also that's often where people with mental illness are looking for community. Maybe they're less comfortable going out, whether because of COVID or their own anxieties other than that. So often online is kind of where they're looking to connect with people.
Father Ryan, with schools reopening largely in person this year, what do you plan to do to help students recover or meet them where they are?
You know, on the first day of class, I will almost certainly quote St. John Paul II's rallying cry, do not be afraid. And I want to encourage our students to seek help when needed, to not be afraid of admitting sometimes the brokenness and the ugly stuff, their fears, doubts, and concerns, to find people they can trust, to find practices of community, of spiritual growth and development, the sacraments, we have so many masses on Marquette's campus, to become liturgically involved and to allow that holistic experience, spiritual, academic, and social, to form and reform and transform their lives. And I'm privileged to be able to offer myself, my shoes, and my heart in their service.
I know that they're grateful for that. And Nicole, they will certainly find you online. Thank you so much for being here with us for this important conversation.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Find out more about Nicole Amalu's mission by visiting thefaceofmercy.org. You can link to resources or even book a speaker for your parish or youth group. Still to come, a major development in the legal battle over abortion. Details on a big pro-life victory from Texas in the Week in Review. Plus, state bureaucrats drag their feet on doling out critical COVID relief funding for religious schools. The superintendent of 175 Catholic schools weighs in. And students, parents, and staff beam with pride as a brand new Catholic school opens on the site of what once was a notoriously rough public housing complex. That good news story when we come back. The nation's strictest state-level abortion ban went into effect in Texas on Wednesday, prohibiting abortion after 6 weeks of pregnancy when a heartbeat is detected. That major development in the legal battle over abortion tops the Week in Review. Texas clinics immediately turned away women seeking abortions after the U.S. Supreme Court refused to block the ban on a 5-4 vote, letting it stand while lower courts take up the case. The Texas law relies on private citizens to sue people who help women get abortions, right down to the Uber driver who takes a woman to a clinic, and eliminates the right to abortion created by Roe versus Wade and Planned Parenthood versus Casey. If found to have violated the law, individuals would have to pay $10,000 to the person who brought the suit against them. This case comes at an important time. This fall, the high court will consider a different case out of Mississippi known as Dobbs versus Jackson Women's Health Organization, which is considered a more direct challenge to the Roe and Casey cases that created the right to abortion. In Northern California, thousands of firefighters are working to contain a massive wildfire that is quickly moving toward famed South Lake Tahoe. Crews have been able to protect some homes and businesses by hosing down homes and dropping fire retardant. But evacuation orders continue for tens of thousands of people, as many mountain communities are still threatened. More than 207,000 acres have burned so far, and the fire is only 23% contained. The CDC is recommending unvaccinated Americans not travel during the Labor Day weekend because of a surge in COVID-19 transmission. Rates of the Delta variant are spiking, and data from Johns Hopkins University indicates an average of 160,000 new COVID cases a day, with unvaccinated people 16 times more likely to be hospitalized. And as schools reopen, the American Academy of Pediatrics says it's seeing a rapid increase in the rate of COVID infections in children. More than 200,000 children tested positive across the nation last week. That's five times higher than a month ago and corresponds with a rapid rise in the number of hospitalizations. During this start of a new school year, Catholic schools around the country are continuing to implement health measures to protect students from COVID-19. In New York City, despite carving the path of opening schools in a safe way, Catholic schools have still had to work hard to make sure they receive their fair share of federal COVID funding. The superintendent of Catholic schools for the Archdiocese of New York, Michael Deegan, joins us now to tell us the latest on the funds they're hoping to receive. Michael, thanks for being here. Federal funds that should be available to Catholic schools have been stuck in Albany. Can you explain why?
I think, Montse, the challenge that state officials and New York City officials have faced is that the federal legislation gave them the ability to dispatch those funds expeditiously. In particular, Senator Schumer, who advocated on behalf of our Catholic schools, made a point of recognizing the federal funds need to get into the hands of our Catholic school children as quickly as possible. Sadly, the bureaucratic and complexities of contracts and procedures that are in place in state government did not allow for that expeditious disbursement of the money. And as a result of it, we have had to work with the state, with Senator Schumer, and now with Governor Hochul. And it appears as if a little bit of good news is that we have made significant progress in working with our elected officials and with state ed, that the monies will be available to us as our children so richly deserve. I think, unfortunately, one of the things that has been most frustrating to us is it is difficult enough to operate and open our schools as successfully as we did last year. I think that we demonstrated across the country that Catholic schools, particularly in New York, were able to open safely last September.
That's
and again,
right.
we will next week. The difficulty is that the federal funds that have been made available to us through the CARES Act and through the American Rescue Plan has been slow to move out of the pockets of the federal and now state officials and city officials into the hands of our children. This pandemic did not discriminate between public school children and religious school children. And this is an issue of religious liberty. The government fails to recognize that our parents who have freely chosen to send their children to a Catholic school deserve the same funds and the same access to the resources that the public schools are receiving.
That's precisely the red tape that you criticized in your New York Post op-ed. And you also talked about the difference between how private schools and public schools are going to use these COVID funds. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
I think, Montse, what I would say about that is, unfortunately, and this is always the case, when the federal funds or state funds are allocated to public school districts, they have exceedingly more latitude to be able to use those monies in ways that they feel are appropriate. Unfortunately, when the money comes to Catholic schools, government money comes to Catholic schools, there are strings attached. There are procedures and protocols that are in place that limit how we might be able to use that money. And I must say that, again, Senator Schumer has loosened the grip on the way in which this money can be used. And we're looking very much, we're looking forward, rather, to making sure that this money gets into our hands. We have numerous initiatives and projects that this money is going to fund, mental health, social and emotional support for our children, new technology for our students, COVID mitigation and remediation for our schools. So there are a large amount of opportunities that we have to use this money. It's just that we have to go through exceedingly complicated red tape to be able to get the money. We are fighting for it. We deserve it. I think that, as I said, that the grip on it is loosening up, and I have to give credit to Albany, particularly with the new governor, at recognizing that the monies that is available to us should come to us.
Right. That's exactly right. Well, it does sound like discrimination to me, so we'll be watching that closely. And I know you're grateful for what Senator Schumer has done so far. We'll be watching that, too. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
A sense of celebration and pride this week in Baltimore, where the first new Catholic school there in nearly 60 years opened up for the first day of school. Mother Mary Lang Catholic School is a state-of-the-art K-8 facility near downtown with a gleaming new chemistry and robotics lab, art and music rooms, a chapel, and a colorful playground. The school was built on a land where crime-ridden public housing high-rise once stood. The majority of the mostly non-Catholic student population is expected to qualify for tuition assistance from the Baltimore Archdiocese. Religion will be taught every day, and the goal is for the children to grow academically, spiritually, mentally, and physically. The school is named for a Haitian American who in 1928 started the first Catholic school in the U.S. for African American students. The Vatican is reviewing Mother Mary Lang for possible canonization. EWTN News In Depth wishes Mother Mary Lang Catholic School many generations of student success.
If you empower people, you know, if you can sustain, if you can have them help themselves, they won't need you.
And empowering the future of Haiti through the dignity of work. The programs that the Felician Sisters have kicked off that are changing the lives of Haitians living in poverty. That story when we return.
When you look at Pope Francis and what his encouraging words always are, is that you need to empower people to live the gospel. And what is the gospel? Love the Lord your God with your whole heart, mind, and soul, and love your neighbor as yourself. And who is our neighbor? Work gives dignity. Work gives dignity. And the more you can keep people working, the more dignity they have in themselves.
As we celebrate Labor Day this coming Monday, we highlight the special call God has for us to work and how work can strengthen us spiritually. In applying our skills and talents to enhance the world around us, we experience a greater sense of self-worth and personal dignity. Creating opportunities for dignified work is what the Felician Sisters in Haiti are doing to help empower the poor. And it's especially important now as villagers face massive challenges after the devastating earthquake 2 weeks ago. We spoke with Sister Marilyn Minter about the sisters' mission.
If you show up, it happens. And we just said, Lord, if you want this, use us and we'll do what you want us to do.
Sister Marilyn says all of the Felician Sisters' work is truly the work of God.
We just showed up. That's all we had to do. Because having a mission of empowerment, you know, when you're doing something like this, you just have to show up and you've got to let God do the leading.
She flew to Haiti after the 2010 earthquake to build a mission. She discovered the great needs of the people.
Four boys came to the door and they said, you know, Mwe Gwangu, I'm hungry.
Hunger is something families here are all too familiar with, as Haiti is ranked as the poorest nation in the Western Hemisphere. Roughly 2.5 million Haitians live in extreme poverty on less than $1.25 a day. And millions are forecasted to suffer severe food insecurity. The other need Haitians brought to the sisters was a desire to learn English.
Because if a Haitian knows another language, they can communicate internationally. So with one little computer, we started this little English school that grew into all the kids in the neighborhood started to come.
Because many were suffering from hunger pains, the sisters began serving hot meals. But their ministry didn't stop there.
Our mission is a ministry of presence, and we walk the streets every day. And we noticed that kids during the day weren't in school. Like, why aren't you in school? One couldn't pay the tuition. Because even though Haiti has a national school, you still have to pay an amount of money, and you have to buy a uniform, you have to buy books, you have to pay a certain amount to, you know, get into the school.
So the Felician sisters began a scholarship program to help families pay for their children to stay in school.
We realized that, well, if we could sponsor a kid to go to school, they would be educated and you could build up the body of Christ. You could empower them.
Those sponsored students could then come to the sisters program to help other children study.
We call it a pay it forward program because any child that is sponsored, they have to pay it forward in the mission. So our mission is the kids' mission, really. It's the teens' mission. It's the young adults' mission.
Every step along the way, they teach about the dignity of work.
We teach them that art of accompaniment, that art of empowerment at an early age, that they need to keep working for the betterment of each other. And how to not only look at yourself, but look beyond. It's about a gospel of life, a gospel of accompaniment, a gospel of discipleship.
New paths helping Haitians build a better future continue to form.
One sister, Sister Mary Isayasha, she is a seamstress. And the Lord opened the door. Well, let's have a sewing school. How do they make school uniforms? They sew. If we could empower women, teach them how to sew, guess what? So she's finished her second class. They've learned how to sew uniforms. They now have jobs. They're empowered. They're sustained. They're independent. And they can help themselves.
The Felician sisters began a mobile clinic that now services 28 dioceses in Jacmel. It's run by Haitians for Haitians. Their mission also provides access to an online college program, which is opening doors for employment. And their latest venture, a soon-to-open bakery.
Which will give jobs, empower women to be the sellers, to run it, to organize it. It's really wonderful how God opens doors for us, you know, so we just have to show up. And that's about all we've been doing, showing up and boom, there it happens.
Showing up, the sisters will break ground on the bakery in October. To find out how you can help the Felician Sisters' incredible mission, head to FeliciansistersNA.org/Haiti. A popular week-long celebration in Boston wrapped up earlier this week, commemorating St. Anthony and St. Lucia. It's a packed festival, and we take you there in our images of the week. This is the 100th anniversary of the Feast of Santa Lucia, and people gathered on the streets and from their balconies to celebrate her as her statue was carried through the streets. Children were brought up to kiss her, and several days later is the highlight of the festival, the confetti-filled grand procession of the statue of St. Anthony lasts 10 hours, and it has been held in Boston for 102 years. The statue is accompanied by 7 marching bands and drum corps, as well as thousands of devotees that sing and pray throughout the North End. Both statues are covered in money, prayer cards, and more as a donation to the church. A thank you for answered prayers and petitions for the future. The annual festival also includes mass and outdoor celebration of the Eucharist and, of course, music and food. And that's it for this edition of EWTN News in Depth. Thank you for joining us. I'm Montse Alvarado. Join us again next week as we continue the conversation about matters important to the Catholic community. We'll see you then.